Hi guys, welcome back. This is Matt Chat, episode 374, featuring the first in a brand new series of interviews with Mr. Tim Lang, the president of Brrapp Games, but a former game designer at New World Computing, where he worked on the Might and Magic series, and Electronic Arts, where he worked on the Medal of Honor franchise. He's got a lot of great stories from all eras of the gaming industry, but in this first part, we're going to focus in on what he's doing now with the Brrapp Games. He's got some pretty cool projects in the pipeline we'll talk about. And then we'll delve in a little bit to his early days with the Commodore 64 and the Intellivision. A lot of great stuff here. So without further ado, here is Mr. Tim Lang. All right, folks, I am here with Tim Lang. He is the president and founder and creative director at Brrapp Games. It's an indie game development company focused on social and mobile, but now branching into console and PC game development. His roots, however, go much further back than that. Indeed, he's worked on some of my favorite series of all time, the Might and Magic series. He's also worked on the Medal of Honor series and much, much more. How are you today, Tim?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing great. So, how is Brrapp doing these days?
Brrapp kind of goes in its ups and downs, you know. Right now, it's getting on an upswing again, which is good. We just had to cancel a game, which was unfortunate, but it happens. We had since it's an indie studio, we depend on a lot of people to do basically free labor. You know, there's not a lot of financing in the background, so basically we try to get some people and say, hey, you love games? Awesome, come help work on this, and hopefully get some royalties in the future. And what happens is life, you know. So a lot of these guys who were working on this game called Mad Mallard, which was a really fun sort of spin on like the Flappy Bird game. They spent all this time working on this game. It was about, I'd say, 99% done.
Wow.
The only things that were left were like little, they wanted to add in little microtransactions and stuff, and which I was like, okay, that's fine, you know. I was basically just executive producing it, so they were working on it by themselves and utilizing the Brrapp resources to put it out. And and then life happened, and everybody said, you know, I can't work on it right now. I got to go do this other thing, and so they all went off their separate ways. And I said, this game is almost done.
99% done. You know, it's crazy.
I asked him to give me the source code so I could just finish it up and get it out there. And the only person who had it was the lead programmer. Despite my insistence on having source control, they used a thumb drive or something. And so the only version he had was like 4 months old. And it was like first playable and not last playable. So that's it.
I take it these weren't seasoned veterans working on this.
No. Usually the guys that get excited about that stuff are kids right out of college trying to build their resume and get a portfolio and stuff. So that was a drag. But at the moment, there's been a lot of good progress on. I'm working on a game called Zombie Gauntlet Live, which is, it started off as kind of like a first-person shooter, that like a randomized kind of web game first-person shooter, and then I got to the point where I was like, well, let me turn this into a full-on first-person shooter, and now I'm like, well, let me add some RPG stuff into it, and so now it's looking kind of like BioShock, sort of, you know, part first-person shooter, very linear, but with role-playing game elements. And I'm hoping to have that done, hopefully by the end of the year.
But any connection there to the old school Gauntlet game?
Yeah, sort of. The idea is that it's part of the Project 2137 universe, And inside that universe, there was a zombie apocalypse in certain parts of the world. And in this particular enclave, which is, you know, in Project 2137, the cities are divided into city-states called enclaves. And in this particular enclave, the major television show is called Zombie Gauntlet Live. So it's a television show within within the game. And it's
a Running Man type scenario.
Exactly, that's what I was going to say. It's very much Running Man. You try to basically they pick on the poor and the downtrodden. They say, hey, come play in this game show, and you get games and prizes, and it's very bloody, and you have a chance of dying. And so they do pull from criminals and things like that. And the main character is actually one of those people. And so he goes on to find, well, not everything is exactly as it seems in the wonderful, wonderful world of the Enclave. Hidden story there.
So this is a game that's set in a universe you created for an earlier game, right? You
said for an earlier game, Project, yeah. So Project 2137, yeah. Which is the game that I have for 2137 in my head is kind of too big for me to do right now. And so that's kind of what I started this Zombie Gauntlet for, was to get some, get something out there, something quick, because 2137 was a really big game. And there's a lot of technical hurdles that I kind of don't have answers for working on a game by myself. So that's right now 2137 is a little bit on hold as I kind of think about that, those ideas, and I've toyed with ideas of maybe doing, instead of doing it like a modern interpretation of a first person RPG, to maybe go back and do it more retro style. I know there's a lot of interest in that retro gaming right now. I just kickstarted one called, Unforgotten Realms, I think. And it's straight up Commodore 64.
Is that a reference to the Gold Box games?
I think it is.
Cool.
But it's, because they're making an Ultima game, because it's that same Ultima, Questron, Legacy of the Ancients kind of perspective. But modern. So it's on, but they're putting it on a Commodore 64. and then it's also
this is really retro.
Yeah, and it's really cool. And the second I saw it, I was like, oh, I'm back in that. I think I got it from Brian Fargo's Facebook feed. I think he backed it and shared it. I'm like, oh my god, I gotta do that. You know, so that's pretty exciting. There's another one that I've been playing called Dungeons of Chaos, which is an iPhone game that's very, very similar in that sort of style. And the benefit about doing that, from my perspective, is those games are easier to make. You know, you don't have to worry about the animations and the 3D modeling of characters and stuff. It's all sprite based, and you can do like, two frame animations and stuff. So that's something I'm thinking about with Project 2137. But I get distracted really easy, so I got to focus on Zombie Gauntlet and get that out before I start getting things like that. But if anybody's got any suggestions about that, if there's a poll out there and say, hey, yeah, do it old school, I'm definitely willing to listen to that.
Yeah, it must be pretty hard to make calls like that and say, well, this game is just too big, it's going to take too long, let me bite off something I can chew.
And that's when I was working with the Mad Mallard team. There was a couple guys who'd worked with me in the past with Brrapp on some other stuff. Like we were trying to do this Facebook game for a while called Wild Frontiers and some other stuff. And I was always, look, focus, keep things small and contained and easy to build. And every time the game would, you know, feature creep. Went, no, stop, slow down. And then I think finally they got the message with Matt Mallard that keep it this small game. And man, I think it was close, you know. But I'm subject to that feature creep myself.
Yeah, it seems like I remember talking to Fargo about something like this, and like I don't know if it was him for sure or not, but I remember one of these producers saying something like that was his job was to come in and say, "Nope, it's done."
yeah, and
you need sometimes you need somebody like that, right?
When I was at basically all the studios I was at, you know, New World, EA, Jail Games, all the places. Usually the feature creep came from above, and
really?
and I'd have to say no, too much, and which is very very, I guess it's kind of weird, but you know, there was a couple times when I was at EA on Medal of Honor where, you know, I started Medal of Honor when it was right in the middle of sort of its life cycle, so Call of Duty had come out, mm-hmm. And so they were looking very closely at Call of Duty because it was really popular, saying, well, look at what they're doing. Now we need to do that. And I would say to my boss, so they, you know, let's focus on what we're planning and not just make a Call of Duty clone out of Medal of Honor. So that's story there.
Yeah, I was wanting to ask you about the stuff in the... that you got in the background there. We got a Millennium Falcon on a red background, a kind of a Buddhist statue. Is there a connection between these items?
No, not really. The Millennium Falcon was a piece of art that a girl I dated drew for me when she found out I was a big Star Wars fan. And it's I love it because it's like it's kind of like the lo-fi kind of art, so it's not realistic, but it's very stylistic, which is great. And the Buddha divider I've gotten into some meditation and things like that, so I have a little area where I do that stuff, and the Buddha divider usually divides that area off from the rest of the world.
Well, let's jump back to the good old days.
Yeah.
A lot of people that watch this show, they're huge Commodore 64 fans, uh-huh. Mega fans, all that good stuff.
Yeah, that's
we're
right.
We're all nostalgic around here. Bard's Tale, Wasteland, you know. Uh-huh. So I understand you were really obsessed with those games yourself as a kid.
Oh yeah. Yeah, for sure. That was when Bard's Tale came out. I was probably eighth grade. And I got it from a friend of mine. Sorry, Brian. He made me a copy.
A pirated copy.
He made, you know, but I only had the one disc. And, you know, if you have you've got the copy back there in your thing, and you know it's a two-disc set. So I had no idea. And I was playing it for a while, I came on went into one of the bars where you say, you know, you ask about the wine or cellar or something. And then it says, insert dungeon disc. And I went, and it just blew me away that there was so much more to this game besides running around this world fighting, running around a town, right? Running around Scarab Ray fighting monsters. And after that, I was hooked. I played them all, played Wasteland. Wasteland's probably my favorite of those old Interplay RPGs. And then, you know, Questron was another one of my favorites. Which I don't remember if I ever finished, but I did play the heck out of that. But that's what got me started.
Legacy of the Ancients, you mentioned that one.
Yeah, Legacy of the Ancients.
Played that one too.
I got that for Christmas, I think, one year, and then I did finish that one, and that was a lot of fun. But that got me into the whole, you know, gave me the creative spark of game development, you know.
Yeah, you said you did some, I guess a lot of us did this, sort of tinkering around with BASIC on the...
Uh-huh, on yeah.
How far did you go with that?
Not very far. And you know, the funny thing is that started with my brother, who I have an older brother who's also a gamer. And he had gotten a book on game programming. And he had created this little enterprise, Starship Enterprise, and made a sprite, and it was moving around the screen. I'm like, we can do that? And so I ran out. I grabbed the book and, you know, I'm looking. And I started making a text adventure. And it didn't. I didn't ever get very far. You know, I got maybe one or two rooms in, and I was, at the time, I didn't know about, you know, with BASIC there was the Go subs and things where you had, you know, you could unify functions together, I did it very linearly, so it was very inefficient.
You always marvel at those. Everybody that sees the games like Zork or whatever, they think, oh, that's so simple. No idea of the complex, like how hard it was to do that parser, you know?
Yeah, and I had, I didn't even think about the parser. I basically, it was just like, you know, get this input. If it matches this, do that. If it doesn't, throw it away.
It's hard enough just to do the press A to do this, and B, you don't have like a multiple choice.
Yeah. And I didn't get much into that until later when Adventure Construction Set came out, which I've got a really funny story on that I think I've told a few times.
This is the Interplay.
It was an EA product.
EA product. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's part of that original set with like the.
Yeah, yeah. It was. I think it was Stuart Smith
Mule
who did. Yeah, yeah, exactly. The same record yeah. label box stuff.
Awesome cover on that.
Yeah, yeah. So I was in college long after my early gaming days. In college, I was studying to be a film composer. And one of the classes we had was a music theory class where we had to write a fugue. And we had to come in with five little melodies. They were called motives, little two-measure pieces of music. And I came up with four of them, and I was stuck for a fifth one. And so I lifted the bit from Adventure Construction Set, from their fugue. And put it in there. And took it into class, and our teacher played all the motives and picked one for us to write the fugue on. And she picked the Adventure Construction Set one. And then one of my friends ratted me out and said, this is, hey, that sounds like a video game. Like, yeah, it is. And she got very upset. It was like, you're supposed to come up with your own. And I said, well, look, you know, Mozart lifted themes all over the place. That's a very common musician thing. And she couldn't say anything about that. She's like, well, you're right. So she let me write the fugue. And it turns out many, many years later, when I was working with a company called Software Magic as a freelancer, we were trying to get a first-person shooter based on Pablo Escobar done. And the guys running the company ran around and introduced me to a bunch of people, and I met David Warhol.
Ah, yeah, I've had him on before.
and so you know, David and I, we talked and you know, we still talk now and again about game stuff, and occasionally I'll like throw a game idea and say, hey, what do you think about this, and so on. So I was browsing through Wikipedia on Adventure Construction Set one day, and I see music written by David Warhol.
he got around.
And I'm like, wait, what? Is my mind completely blown that this fugue that I had stolen, I stole from David? So I immediately emailed him, and we had a nice good chat. Turned out that fugue was his music theory homework assignment. and then it became my music theory homework assignment.
Who'd he copy it from? That would be.
So that's a good question. You'll have to ask him on that.
Didn't he do the music for Pool of Radiance too?
He may have. He was. I know he did a lot of music before the days of real time and that. So
I think he did a. Wasn't a television guide.
Yeah, he was.
Yeah, which is my next question for you. You know, because that was. I guess that's the console you happen to have.
Yes, the Intellivision. Yeah. I loved that thing when I was a kid.
The sports games on there.
I played everything. You know, anything I could get my hands on at the time, you know. I was, of course, big into the Dungeons & Dragons, the Advanced Dungeons & Dragons game, and then Oh, you've got that back there.
Yeah, just...
Yes, that's the one. And, of course, Treasure of Tarmin, which was that unofficial sequel. Yeah, you know, it's funny that I didn't expect, when I was a kid, I had no idea about the Intellivision until one day my dad came home with it. Came home with it with, like, five or six games, and my mom was pissed because it was not cheap and we were not rich.
Your dad was a gamer too, so it must have been.
A little bit. He was more a musician, but we did have a couple game systems that he brought home. Like it wasn't a Pong, but it was one of those Pong knockoffs that had probably five or six games that you switched on a knob and stuff. But it was definitely not the original Pong, and I don't know what it was. And I've gone through
there were hundreds of them, right?
Yeah, and I've gone through all the retro game consoles. You know, I went through when they had it at E3 as like, that's not it, that's not it, that's not it, and never found it. No idea what it was. But yeah, the Intellivision was you know, I probably played every game on it. Utopia was one of my favorites. That was fun. Real fun
stuff. I think it's Don Daglo. How do you say his name?
Daglos? I'm not sure.
Daglo, probably.
I think so. I'm not sure who did that.
Anyway, very ahead of its time game, though, for sure.
Yeah, for sure. And you know, I've run into a couple of those. Now they're called the Blue Sky Ranger guys.
Yeah.
And one of the guys I worked with at Spin Master was Bob Bryant. He was dialed into a lot of those guys, so he introduced me to a few of them, and we had nice little Intellivision conversations, and I tried not to be a little fanboy.
Blue Sky Rangers. Yeah. That sounds like a great band name.
Yeah, well they're all basically it's just the collection of old Intellivision guys who they put out the Intellivision Lives CD-ROM, and I think they still do like iPhone games and stuff, but I think it's like, you know, they do it in their spare time kind of dealio, I think.
And that's all for this week's episode. Hope you guys enjoyed that. We're just getting started here with Tim. He's got a lot of great stories we haven't even got into the Might and Magic stuff yet, the Electronic Arts stuff. Just tons of great content coming your way, so stay tuned. As always, I want to thank you for your part in making these interviews possible. Couldn't do the show without you. It would depend 100% on your support to keep these episodes coming. So if you want to do your part, just head over in the show notes there and look for the Patreon site. You can also go to mattchat.us if you want to go the PayPal route. Or you can click on my good old games links and support the show that way. However you do it, folks, I just really want you to know I really, really appreciate it. And thank you for that support. Really means a lot to me. All right, let's see. What about that news from the Matt Cave? Well, it's been a couple of weeks, I know. Good part about that, though, is the news kind of builds up, and I get lots of cool stuff to choose from here in the news segment. First off, though, I want to mention Charles Clerk. You might remember his game, what was it, Swords and Sorcery Underworld. I looked at that back in 355. Well, he's back, and he's on Steam Greenlight with a game called, Iron Ruler. Now, this is a turn-based strategy game. It's under review at Steam Greenlight, like I said. It's inspired by the Lords of Conquest game. It has artwork by Joseph Caesar. It's really, really, really nice artwork, in my opinion. So go check that out on Greenlight. I know Charles would appreciate it. And then Thamer. Oh, good old Thamer. What's he writing in about? A game called Domina. This is a game that came out a few weeks ago on Steam. It's acquire, train, upgrade, and whip your brutish gladiators towards bloody victory in the ruthless arenas of ancient Rome. Features pixel art and has some great reviews on there, so go check this out. It's only $9.99 on Steam there. Kind of, you know, got to see these graphics kind of remind me of the Serpent in the Staglands style. I wonder if that's what they were going for, if they're totally unrelated. Anyway, let me know what you think about Domina. And then Stig wrote in with a couple of stories. The first is just absolutely unbelievable. Do you remember the game Night Trap, a full motion video game? I mean, it's kind of infamous, right? That theme song. I actually happen to love the theme song to it, but a lot of people don't. Anyway, you'll never guess. Yes, they are remaking this. It's a 25th anniversary. How old does that make you feel? I mean, 25th anniversary edition of this. Wow. It's the Screaming Villains putting this out. If you go to their website, oh, it's for the PS4, by the way. You know, if I don't own a PS4, but I might buy one just to play this. How sad would that be, huh? Anyway, I was going to say, if you go to the ScreamingVillains.com website, you can actually download there the theme song for Night Trap for free. So if you haven't heard it before, please go download it. I think everybody should listen to it at least once. Okay, what else? Oh, Stig also wrote in about this game Sceal. This is an Irish folklore adventure. Came out last year, but it's just got a big overhaul, big update. They got iOS and Android ports for it now. This features a vibrant watercolor paint palette and a soundtrack sung in Irish by three renowned folk singers. So as you can see, there's a really unique art style and gameplay mechanics on this one. And it's only $5. So if you like Irish folklore, I think you'd be interested in that. But I think, you know, for $5, how can you go wrong? Go check it out. All right. So thank you for Stig, Thomer, and Charles for all the wonderful news. What about that ale of the week? Well, this week I've got a Lagunitas Unlimited Release. Anyway, Lagunitas Imperial Stout. This is brewed and bottled by the Lagunitas Brewing Company out of Petaluma, California, and Chicago, Illinois. So I guess we don't know which of those it is this time. A lot of information here. We got IBUs, 72.45, OG of 1.092, and alcohol of 9.9%. So this is exactly what you'd want to see in an Imperial Stout, very high alcohol content. And, you know, I really had to almost break out a magnifying glass to read this, but they have a little write-up on the side of the bottle. It's actually a pretty funny, so I thought I'd read this to you. So let's see. Having downed his fourth Imperial Stout of the day, the wild-eyed charlatan from Volvostoknayevsky, something like that, belched and hollered for the Tsarina to enter his chamber and bend herself to his will. The economy was a wreck, and revolt was just around the corner. Nicky the Tsar dude was off playing soldier like any pale nobleman with a hemorrhagic skin condition would. Such were the final days of the old empire. Reactionary, decadent Sputnik, Stroganoff, weird, and drunk. But even as the proletariat countryside labored under inhuman conditions and a threat of being sent to a futile war in the East, they wisely took the time to slam back an imperial stout or two. After all, life can be a real sucka, as they say in the old country. Big, black, bourgeois, Bolshoi, a belligerent, buxom, and scary. This is our version of the chaotic end of an era in a bottle. Wow. So like I say, that is printed very, very fine print. I don't think I could do that without my glasses on. Anyway, if the beer is halfway as good as that write-up, we're in for a real treat. So let's get this Lagunitas Imperial Stout open and see what it's all about. All right, so I got some of this Lagunitas Imperial Stout Unlimited Release here in the rather excellent drinking horn. And I wanted to say, some people have asked me where I got this horn, and every now and then I get this thing about Rimfrost, sort of a company that does these. But my advice, if you want to get one from the same person I got mine, go to the website in the show notes, Viking Inn. This is a guy named Richard Steinar, and he's a real personality around these parts. He goes to the Vikings games. He goes to the Renaissance festivals and things like that. That's where I met him. And he makes these horns, and he runs a Viking-themed bed and breakfast. And the reason I bring all this up is that he's actually going to make me a customized or a custom drinking horn. He's working on it now. So as excellent as this one is, expect a really a fabulous horn here, hopefully pretty soon. But if you want one of your own, just go to that link on the show notes and you'll see what, you know, make a deal with Richard for those. All right, so you have to excuse me. I'm a little bit congested today, but you can definitely smell the, I guess I would call that kind of a raisiny aroma on this. A little bit of a, yeah, kind of a grape, sort of a grape juice quality to it. Anyway, smells really sweet. Maybe a little bit of a licorice-like quality to it as well. Anyway, no alcohol fumes or anything like that coming off of it. No strange chemical aromas, shall we say. Actually, it smells quite good. Again, I'm a little bit congested, so I take that with a grain of salt. But anyway, let's give it a taste. Oh, wow. Oh, wow. Wow, this is fabulous stuff. Oh, really just sweet and crisp. Man, I gotta try this again. Man, they have just really nailed this. I was kind of a little worried after that wacky write-up on the bottle. Didn't know how good this was going to be. But man, this is like one of the best Imperial Stouts I think I've ever had. You really get that nice balance of sort of chocolatey flavors, a little bit of a roasted-like quality to it. It's sweet, but not too sweet. Bitter, but not too bitter. A little bit of a cherry-like quality to that. You know, what can I say? Really, really nice. I'm going to try it again here. Man, I just don't see how you go wrong with this. I got, you know, no criticisms of this one at all. I think it's probably the best Imperial Stout I've ever had. I'd even go that far. And it was only like maybe $5 or $6, which is kind of crazy. Sometimes these things go anywhere from like $20 to $30 a bottle. I'll give it one more taste here. Yeah, that is just absolutely amazing. If you like Imperial Stouts, definitely look for this. Lagunitas Unlimited Release Imperial Stout out of California and Chicago. So if we get it all the way here in Minnesota, it shouldn't be too hard for you to find. I think you'll really, really like this one. So no question about it. Full 5 out of 5 drinking horns on this. Lagunitas Imperial Stout, highly recommended. All right, so let's wrap up with a quote. And I was looking for quotes about music and plagiarism and Mozart and all that kind of stuff, because we talked about it a little bit in the episode, right? And I came across this one from Howard Dietz. He's a musician and a publicist. He's actually the guy that came up with that MGM Lion Roar intro, or what do they call that, the title card. He's the one that came up with that. And he also came up with this quote that I thought was a lot of fun and something to ponder. Anyway, it goes something like this. Composers shouldn't think too much. It interferes with their plagiarism. See you guys next week.
Back. Only in a rerun.